وكفى بالله حسيبا ما كان محمد أبا أحد من رجالكم ولكن رسول الله وكان الله بكل شيء عليما
Ey Müslümanlar! Biliniz ki devletimiz İslamiyet'in adı ve canı olan Moskov, İngiliz ve Fransız hükümetleriyle muharip bulunuyor. Emir-ül Mümin'in Hazretleri sizi cihada davet ediyor.
The turn of the 20th century saw a broad decline and the weakening of the once mighty Ottoman Caliphate in Turkey, resulting from the ever-increasing incursions and conquests by the British and other colonial forces into the Muslim heartland. The early 1900s were characterized by a sequence of cultural and material defeat for the Muslim world. Many thinkers and academics foresaw the eventual collapse of the Islamic governing body and its inevitable subjugation to the British, French, and Italian forces. This reality was perhaps more apparent within the Eastern European frontiers of the Ottoman Caliphate, and it was in the midst of this critical and pivotal era of the Muslim Ummah from within the Eastern European post of Albania that a young child was destined to be born. It was Muhammad Nasiruddin bin Nuh Najati bin Adam al-Albani, who was later to be known to the world by his nisba al-Albani, and known to his students and his close associates by his kunya, Abu Abdir Rahman. He was born in the year 1914 into a poor family in the city of Ashkodera, which was then the capital city of Albania, where he spent the first 9 years of his childhood. Nasiruddin was the son of Albania's Grand Mufti. His father was a renowned scholar of the Hanafi school of thought. He had spent many years in the Turkish Institute of Sharia before returning to Albania to assume the post of Grand Mufti. But Albania, like many of the Eastern European countries of the time, was under the reign of secularist political parties with openly anti-religious agendas. The Albanian national leader was Ahmed Zugu, a staunch supporter and admirer of the secularists such as Mustafa Kemal Ataturk of Turkey. He even copied Ataturk's policies and imported them into Albania by making it illegal to wear the hijab and by banning the call to prayer in the Arabic language. He decreed that all calls to prayer should be made in the Bosnian language. Nasiruddin al-Albani's family decided to escape the encroaching influence of Zugu's secular philosophies and political agenda by making hijra to the Levant, also known as Bilad al-Sham. The small community of migrants from Albania were religious people inclined to the practice of Islam, but they had to flee the region in order to safeguard their religious identity and the identity of their children. Al-Albani and members of his Albanian community, who were also migrants to Syria, were later to be known as the Arnuti, which was one of the indigenous names of their people. In Damascus, Nasiruddin was blessed to have been in the midst of many eminent and learned scholars. The city was buzzing with ancient libraries and study circles, which was a world away from the situation back in Albania. The young student was now in close proximity to the famous Zahiriya Library. It would soon become a second home for the keen student of knowledge. The young Nasiruddin al-Albani received his first exposure to Islamic studies at the hands of his esteemed and capable father, a scholar in his own right. Under his father's tutelage, he studied the rules of tajweed, elocution, Arabic grammar, and morphology, as well as reading the canonical manuals of jurisprudence in the Hanafi school of thought, namely Mukhtasar al-Quduri and other great scholarly works. The young man was also enrolled into local seminaries, which would enhance his knowledge and help him to further his studies under the tutelage of Syrian scholars. But life as a migrant was tough on Nasiruddin and his family. So in order to support himself and secure his future in the economy, he became an apprentice and took on the vocation of carpentry and horology. He would go on to master the art of horology and earn his living as a watch repairer. Contrary to what some adversaries and detractors have accused him of, Sheikh Nasiruddin had in fact studied with many reputable and recognized traditional scholars from Syria. He studied under a Sheikh Muhammad Sa'id al-Burhani, who taught him Maraq al-Falah, a seminal Hanafi manuscript. He also studied under Sheikh Allama Bahjatul Baytar, among many other notable scholars of Damascus. The young Nasiruddin was very studious and intelligent. He occasionally recounted his youthful obsession with reading books of all genres, including popular titles as well as rare and obscure literary works. But his interest in the prophetic tradition and the science of hadith was sparked by the monumental work and publication of Sheikh Rashid Rida in his popular periodical magazine Al-Manar. Rashid Rida and his critical analysis of Imam al-Ghazali's phenomenal book Ihya Ulumuddin caused the young Nasiruddin to explore the field of hadith criticism in greater detail. So enthusiastic and captivated was the young student of knowledge that his life would soon be consumed by the study and analysis of hadith. Now empowered with a new direction and enthusiastic to acquire as much knowledge of the science as possible, the young Nasiruddin al-Albani found himself in a predicament. He was too poor to purchase the manuscripts and stationery required for his new course of study, but that would not deter him in his pursuit of knowledge. Instead, the young student would walk down the busy streets of Damascus, collecting used invitation cards and pieces of scrap paper from the side of the road. He used these discarded pieces of paper to write extensive notes wherever he found space to transcribe his newly found knowledge. This was also the early practice of the great Imam and scholar Muhammad ibn Idris al-Shafi'i, who was also stricken by childhood poverty and obliged to collect scrap paper outside the administrative office of the Khalifa in order to record extensive study notes during his adolescence. Nasiruddin al-Albani also rented books from the local libraries. By the age of 17 years of age, Nasiruddin had already compiled a 3-volume document with over 2,000 pages on the topic of hadith criticism. The young student soon became recognized in the study circles of Damascus, and barely out of his teens, he became sought after for answers to questions on hadith and the science of textual criticism. However, Nasiruddin soon ran into a huge stumbling block at home, when one of the books he wrote against the mystical and unorthodox practice of praying in graveyards reached his father's attention. Nasiruddin was soon kicked out of his home. After supporting his point of view with various textual proofs and evidence, while refusing to blindly follow his father's opinions and his preference for the Hanafi school of thought. But despite the intellectual drift between father and son, the twain were soon reunited, and the young student of knowledge regained his father's love and support. His father would even seek his counsel concerning the authenticity of certain narrations and traditions. But the young man's knowledge was not acquired by reading books alone. He was perhaps an ardent and somewhat excessive reader, but he was by no means an autodidact, as many claim him to have been. The young scholar did not extract his vast knowledge from the inanimate pages buried beneath the dusty covers of some obscure books he found at the old library, but he pursued studies in the science of hadith criticism under the guidance of notable scholars such as Sheikh Muhammad Ragib At-Tabakh of Halab, who eventually awarded the young Nasiruddin with an ijaza, or a certificate of authorization to teach and relate traditions. But to Nasiruddin's own admission, the certificates of authority did not mean much to him. He was in love with the science itself and found motivation in the research and study of hadith, not in acquiring accolades and certificates. By the 1930s, Nasiruddin al-Albani began to specialize in the field of hadith studies. He was barely in his early 20s at the time. He transcribed and commented on al-Iraqi's monumental work, Al-Mughni. He followed this with a series of influential lectures and books, as well as contributing in articles for the Al-Manar magazine. He spent much of his time in a Zahiriya library in Damascus. He would make daily visits to the reading room, where he spent between 6 to 8 hours at a time reading through classical manuscripts and treatises. But occasionally he would spend up to 12 hours in the library, all the while copying text, researching rare scripts, and reading through volumes of classical text in solitude, only breaking his routine to eat and pray. He often arrived before the librarians in the morning and left in the evening way after they left for their shift. It was due to his rigorous study routine that he came under the attention of the librarian staff, who offered him a room of his own. He soon became a part of the furniture. It has been reported that as the years went by, the Sheikh continued to study ardently in the library room assigned to him. He read all the books then available and repeated the cycle upon completing his reading, hoping to learn more and to pick up on subtle points he may have missed the first time round. He spent years reading and working through classical manuscripts and rare titles. But the fruits of his labor were evident when he presented the librarians with a full catalogue of books in the library. He compiled a list and indexed all the manuscripts by author, topic, and subject matter. He was even able to identify anonymous works that had been unidentified due to poor referencing and a general lack of clarity in the text. He was able to do this by reading all the books in the library and correlating citations from books in the same library. By this effort, he helped preserve many classical manuscripts and documents. In fact, some of the books that were present in the library were not even known to the staff until the Sheikh pointed them out in his discoveries. These discoveries opened a new treasure trove of scholarly work and helped a new generation of researchers and students of knowledge to further their studies with this recovery of these priceless manuscripts. In fact, so deep was the Sheikh's love of literature and learning that it was once reported by Dr. Mahmoud Al-Mirah that he witnessed the day when Sheikh Al-Albani climbed the ladder in the Zahiriya library and picked out a manuscript from the shelves. He immediately opened the book and was so consumed by its content, to the extent to which he stood on the ladder for 6 hours uninterrupted and unaware of the time that had passed him by. Sheikh Nasiruddin al-Albani soon earned a reputation for his love of hadith and his studious commitment to the pursuit of authentic knowledge.
كويتانشي اكريمي دا حديثة في بيغمير صلى الله عليه وسلم يعني في تنفت ان الاسلام بدا غريبا وسيعود غريبا فطوبى للغرباء.
غرباء غرباء غرباء غرباء غرباء غرباء.
شيخ الألباني began delivering informal weekly lectures starting in the year 1954, and by the year 1960 his popularity began to alarm the Syrian secret services. But despite al-Albani's apolitical stance, he was soon subjected to consistent surveillance operations.
لا ليس ثابتا ولكن لا بأس من استعمال ذلك أحيانا.
بارك الله
وفي كبارك.
المهم هي رأيك في يعني في ذلك رأت نفسها على شرطة كثيرة على الطريق.
أيوة
رأت على ذلك الطريق رأت الرسول صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وسلم كيف شايفه.
Ти си ружа дженецка, најлепшега мириса. Ти си чежња мукнинска, уздахашка испреса. Због тебе, због тебе, Ахмеде, Мухаммеде, моја душа тугује да те грли саду.
After a number of his works appeared in print, Sheikh Muhammad Nasiruddin al-Albani received the generous invitation to teach hadith at the University of Medina. His invitation was extended to him by the Grand Mufti of Saudi Arabia and the Chancellor of the University. Sheikh Nasiruddin al-Albani became the founder and chief lecturer at the hadith faculty in the Islamic University of al-Medina. However, this appointment was not long-lived. Unbeknown to many admirers and followers of Sheikh Nasiruddin al-Albani, there are reports that the Sheikh left the University of al-Medina following his opposition to the view that the niqab, the face veil worn by Muslim women, was compulsory in Islam. Accordingly, he provided evidence from the hadith demonstrating clearly the voluntary practice of wearing the veil. He also supported his findings with various authentic texts and irrefutable evidences, which he compiled in his book entitled Jilbab al-Mar'at al-Muslima. With this document, he presented his opinion, based on the Quran and the authenticated hadith literature, that women were not obliged or compelled to cover their faces. However, if they choose to do so, then it would be their personal decision, for which they would be rewarded by God. But the practice should not be imposed on women as a compulsory act of compliance, as was the general practice and the accepted norm in Saudi Arabia. His courage and intellectual integrity shone through during this episode of brief disquiet at the university. Although some scholars have also defended the opposing view, they still admired his knowledge and specialism in the field. There were no personal attacks or attempts to defame the Sheikh due to this disagreement. Following this brief event, the Sheikh left Saudi Arabia after having served 3 years at the university. He subsequently returned to Damascus and resumed his work as a watch repairer. Upon his return to Damascus, Sheikh Nasiruddin al-Albani continued his research and students flocked to his circles of knowledge. It is reported from reliable sources that the Sheikh would teach up to 6 hours a day. One of his students was reputed to have even recorded 6,000 lectures delivered by the Sheikh. Sheikh Nasiruddin al-Albani visited several countries to deliver seminars and lectures. Amongst them were Qatar, Egypt, Kuwait, the United Arab Emirates, Spain, and the United Kingdom. But for various reasons, he was forced to emigrate a number of times, moving from Syria to Jordan, then back to Syria again, then to Beirut, then to the United Arab Emirates, and back to Jordan. Sheikh Muhammad Nasiruddin al-Albani, like all men of distinction, was also a man who had many opponents and adversaries, even from the scholarly class. This was best illustrated by the sad fact that some of his scholarly peers had joined forces in order to report him to the Grand Mufti of Syria, on the false premise that he was teaching a seditious and subversive puritanical dogma. The Mufti escalated the matter and reported it to the director in charge of security matters, who later summoned Sheikh al-Albani for a serious discussion. Following the meeting, it was discovered that the complaint was baseless and the Sheikh was free to go, but the damage was already done and his movements were now being monitored. Yet despite Sheikh al-Albani's apolitical nature, he was still persecuted several times by the Syrian regime. In 1969, Sheikh Mohammed Nasiruddin al-Albani was seized by the Syrian government in a mass crackdown on many Sunni clerics. He subsequently spent a brief time in prison before they were all released. Meanwhile, Sheikh Abdul Aziz bin Abdullah bin Baz intervened with the Saudi educational management and persuaded them to receive Sheikh al-Albani a second time so that he may serve as the head of higher education in Islamic law in Mecca. This second term of employment lasted even less time than his first post at the University of Al-Madinah. Some have cited reports of differences between the Sheikh and the Saudi establishment. So he returned to Syria, where he was jailed a second time during the year 1979. Following his release, he decided to make Hijra to Jordan and settled there. Over a period of 60 years, Sheikh al-Albani's lectures and publications were highly influential in the field of Islamic studies, and many of his works became referential points for other Islamic scholars. Yet he supported himself and his family by fixing watches in his modest workshop. He used to work 3 hours daily, except for Thursdays and Fridays. The late Sheikh also maintained mutual relationships with his fellow contemporaries in the field of Islamic sciences. He was a dear friend and comrade of the eminent Saudi cleric Sheikh Abdul Aziz bin Baz in a friendship that lasted for 40 years, wherein both men spoke highly of one another.
أعوذ بالله السميع العليم من الشيطان الرجيم من همزه ونفثه ونفخه بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين الرحمن الرحيم مالك يوم الدين إياك نعبد وإياك نستعين اهدنا الصراط المستقيم صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين.
He died on Saturday, October the 2nd in the year 1999, following the afternoon Asr prayer. He was aged 88 years old. It was in the same year when he won the King Faisal International Prize for his contribution to scholarship in Islamic studies. Sheikh Muhammad Nasiruddin al-Albani's body was buried in Al-Hamlan graveyard, a walking distance from his home. It is reported that over 5,000 mourners attended his funeral prayers that day. Sheikh Muhammad Nasiruddin al-Albani was the author of hundreds of books, some of which exceeded a total of 40 volumes each. His call for a revision to the old way of thinking lasted many decades. He lectured, wrote articles, authored books, taught at prestigious universities, and influenced an entire generation of brilliant scholars and legal theorists. Above all, he challenged the scholarly establishment to review and re-engage the classical text with a renewed zeal and sense of urgency. He provided a new spring of rejuvenation to the science and discipline of hadith studies, one that was slowly fossilizing and stagnating as more academics were only willing to view the text with a passive eye rather than a critical eye, and the analytical approach that was befitting and wholly necessary for the advancement and reawakened effort to reclaim and re-establish the lofty principles and truths conveyed by the authentic traditions. May Allah grant Sheikh Nasiruddin al-Albani a great reward for his contributions, and may He grant him paradise.
Priyatam Papam, Tari Papam, Priyatam Papam.